Heirloom. Organic. Hybrid. Non-GMO. These are all terms that are used to refer to the common seed, and at times it can be a little confusing. Hi, I'm Gardener Scott. Join me as I clear up some of that confusion and move toward understanding seeds. So as I look through my seed packets, it's clear why this can be confusing. Here's a package of basil seeds that are organic. Here's a package of the exact same type of basil seeds that aren't organic. And here's a package of the same type of basil seeds that aren't organic, but they're pelleted. Here's a squash that is a hybrid. Here's a tomato that's a hybrid. Here's a tomato that is an heirloom and organic. Here's a spinach that's organic and also a hybrid. With so many choices and so much terminology, what does it all mean? Let's begin by discussing the garden plants that produce the seeds. And pretty much all of your garden plants fall into two basic categories. You have hybrid plants and you have open pollinated plants. Now, hybrid plants, I think, have gotten a bad rap lately because so many gardeners are focused on growing heirloom varieties without fully understanding what that means, that they begin to think there's something wrong with growing hybrid plants. And there's nothing wrong with hybrids at all. A hybrid is nothing more than the offspring of two different parents. I recently visited my son and his family. They have a little puppy. It's a Yorkie poo. Now, a Yorkie poo has a Yorkshire Terrier as one parent and a poodle as the other parent. It's a Yorkie poo. That puppy is a hybrid. So in the garden, that's exactly the way the plants come about. Let's say you're trying to develop a pink flower. Well, if you take a parent that has a red flower and you take a different parent that has a white flower, and you pollinate them together, the seed theoretically would produce a pink flower. That's the basic idea of hybrids, though that's really quite simplistic. And so what the seed companies will do is cross one parent with a different type of parent to give an offspring that produces something special. Now, one of my favorite tomatoes is the Super Sweet 100 hybrid. It produces a lot of fruit, cherry size, super sweet, and I love growing it. But if I save this seed and try to grow more Super Sweet 100, it doesn't work. In fact, it doesn't work at all. Hybrids exist for one generation. And so often you'll see them referred to as a F1 seed. An F1 basically just means the first generation of seed from two different parents. So when you plant the hybrid or F1 seeds, you will get the plant that's on the seed package because the company knows that they've already done the hard work of crossing the parents to give you the seed that you're looking for. But if you save the seed and plant it for the next year, who knows what's going to happen? And I actually experimented with this a number of years ago. I had a delicious yellow cherry tomato, and I saved some of them at the end of the year, saved the seed, and then the following season, I planted about 20 tomato plants from that seed. And what did I get? Was it wonderful, yellow, cherry, delicious tomatoes? Well, some of the plants gave me red cherry tomatoes. And some of the plants gave me yellow cherry tomatoes that were actually quite sour. And some of the plants gave larger red tomatoes. And another plant gave me large orange tomatoes. Basically, the genetics were all screwed up. So even though I planted a yellow, delicious cherry tomato, the seeds did not grow true. And that's a term you'll hear referred to seeds, is whether they produce true to what their parentage was. That brings us to open pollinated plants, the second category. And open pollinated plants always bear true. That means that the mother and the father plants produce an offspring. And if you save the seed from that offspring, it will be the exact same plant as the mother and the father. So here's a bison tomato. The mother plant was a bison tomato, the father plant was a bison tomato, and these seeds will give me bison tomatoes. If I now grow these plants, save the tomato seeds and plant them next year, I will have bison tomato plants. And if I save those seeds and plant them the year after that, I will have bison tomato plants. So open pollinated plants bear true. You can save the seed and expect the exact same plant. But there is an important caveat when I say that open pollinated plants bear true. A bison tomato plant will provide future bison tomato plants as long as the bison flowers are pollinated by another bison tomato flower. If you have squash in your garden and nearby you're growing a different type of squash, they're both open pollinated. And the cross-pollination can result in a hybrid. So if you save the seed from either plant, you really don't know what you're going to end up with. So to get open pollinated plants to bear true, you really need to work to ensure that both parents are the same type of plant. And now that brings us to heirloom plants. All heirloom plants are open pollinated. Now, the exact definition of heirloom has not definitively been determined by the gardening community. Generally speaking, it means that a plant with a lineage at least 50 years old is an heirloom. Craig LeHoulier, in his book Epic Tomatoes, points out that the first successful hybrid tomato was Burpee's Big Boy in 1949. So for him and many others, that is the mark that determines whether a plant is heirloom or not, pre-1950 or post-1950. Whatever, heirlooms have a long history. This bison tomato is sold by Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds, a company that I love. They specialize in heirlooms. This bison goes back to 1937. So, the plant I'm growing this year in my garden will be the exact same type of plant that was first produced in 1937. That's an heirloom. There are some heirloom plants that go back well over 100 years. You can buy seeds from plants that have been produced at Mount Vernon or Monticello that go back almost 200 years. And I think that's one reason why heirlooms have become so popular. It's that connection to our past and to our heritage. So buying heirloom seeds connects us to our history. And that's probably why a lot of gardeners are focusing so much on heirloom seeds. But it's easy to forget why hybrids were developed, like Burpee's Big Boy in 1949. The hybrids that have existed since 1950 have been developed for very specific reasons, like disease resistance, or production, or taste. There's lots of reasons why hybrids may be a good choice in your garden. I grow both. I have hybrids and I have open pollinated heirlooms. It's purely a personal choice, and one really isn't better or worse than the other unless you're trying for a very specific trait, a particular color, or a particular taste. That's when you do a little more research and find out if a hybrid or an heirloom is best. As soon as the discussion of hybrid seeds begins, there will be someone that raises the issue of GMO seeds. GMO is genetically modified organism, and it's been in the press quite a bit in recent years about the GMO seeds. Well, you really don't need to worry. GMO seeds are produced at the commercial level. They're for big agricultural farms, and the GMO seeds have been developed to fight disease or to fight insects. There's lots of reasons. It costs a lot to develop a GMO seed, so you are almost guaranteed that any packet you buy at your store, your nursery, or online will not be a GMO seed. It will be non-GMO. Just to be sure, a number of nurseries and online seed producers have taken the Safe Seed Pledge. So if you see a company that comments about the Safe Seed Pledge, that means they guarantee none of their seeds are GMO. Partly because of the concern about GMOs, many gardeners have begun to focus on organic gardening. And part of that includes organic seeds. There are many seed companies, Seeds of Change among them, that have really established their reputation by selling certified organic seed. Now, what does that mean? Well, governments around the world have established criteria about what it means to grow organically. In the United States, it's the USDA that determines the parameters. And it takes a number of years to become a certified farm that produces certified organic crops. The seed from those crops is certified organic seed. It's not something you and I can just do. It requires certification. But it means something. It means that these growers, these seed producers, are following established guidelines to produce seed that is organic. After all that effort to become certified organic, does that mean that organic seeds are better? Here's a package of Genovese basil seeds, certified organic. And here's a package of Genovese basil seeds that's not organic. Which one is better? Well, they're the same. The seeds that are in these packages will produce the same type of basil. And the basil that you harvest will taste the same, whether it came from certified organic seed or not certified organic seed. The difference is the philosophy. Do you want to support a company like Seeds of Change that is really trying to enhance awareness within the gardening community about how we grow, how we manage our land, how we take care of the earth? That's where the certified organic really comes into play. It's a mindset. It's how you garden. These certified organic seeds, I hate to say, are almost three times the cost of the non-certified organic. And that becomes a factor for many gardeners. If I can, I choose organic seed because I garden organically as a philosophy, as a way of doing things. But I'm not exclusive. If I find a seed I like, something I can use, and it's not organic, I'll save some money and I'll buy it. To add to the confusion, you've got pelletized seeds, but it's really not a big deal. These are also Genovese basil seeds. They're pelletized. The company that does it is Ferry Morse, and they specialize in that. What they do is take a seed and put a coating around it. All natural materials like clay and perlite and lime, which will dissolve in the soil. And they color it. So these basil seeds are a nice bright green. When it comes time to planting, instead of trying to hunt for those little seeds to put in the ground, you've got a nice big bright green one. And you can see the seed where you're putting it, and it makes sowing quite a bit easier. It has nothing to do with organics or hybrids or anything else. It's just a coating on the seed. That brings us to a recap. Hybrid seeds? Well, they're the first generation produced by two different types of parents to produce a plant that gives us a particular trait or a series of traits that we think would be beneficial in our garden. But if we save those seeds and plant them, who knows what we're going to get? Open pollinated plants, however, they bear true. The parents are the same. They produce a plant that is the same. The seeds of that plant produces another plant that is the same, and so on for generations to follow. Heirloom seeds, they're all open pollinated, and they come from some of those plants that had generations and generations to develop. GMO seed, it's really nothing to be concerned about because it's commercial. You're never going to see a GMO seed packet in your store or wherever you shop for seed. Organic seeds, well, they are something special. It is something that you should consider. It's a mindset. It's a way of gardening that really takes into account what we're doing to our planet, in our own little space of the planet, our garden. But organic seeds and non-organic seeds will produce the same plants. It ultimately comes down to how you garden and if you want your plants to begin as organic seeds. And pelletized seeds, any of the above could be pelletized. It's just a way to make the seed easier when it comes time to put it in the ground. And there you have it. Understanding seeds. If you have any comments or questions or wish to subscribe, just let me know below. If you like the video, you can give me a thumbs up and share it. I'm Gardener Scott. Enjoy gardening.